Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Fermanagh GAA TV. This is our last of our four webinars on coaching. We've had three great weeks so far. We've enjoyed Stephen Poacher, we've enjoyed Eoin Mooney, and last week we had a terrific reaction to Stephen Jackson and Niall Smith, who were with us talking about video analysis, which went down very, very well. Tonight, the focus is all about player development within clubs, and I am joined for this discussion topic by, well, three wise men is how I would describe them, and I suppose they don't need a whole lot of introduction because they're household names in the GAA here in Fermanagh and also in counties further afield. So I'm delighted to welcome on to Fermanagh GAA TV Marty O'Brien from the Devonish St Mary's Club, Shaun Doherty from Kinnaly Brian Boroughs, and Eoin Bradley, an outsider for tonight, but well known in Fermanagh from the Killyclare St Mary's Club as well in Tyrone. Lads, the three of you are very, very welcome to Fermanagh GAA TV. Thanks for joining us.
Cheers, Jet. Thanks for having us.
No problem.
Good. You are all looking well and keeping well and enjoying lockdown. Maybe we're coming out of lockdown. Shaun, we'll start with you. You're a busy man. You've three young children. How has all that been going for you?
To be honest, this is definitely an experience now. I suppose initially, like most people, you enjoyed maybe the few weeks just to relax, switch off, spend as much time as possible with your family. But, you know, I suppose everybody at this stage now is probably itching maybe to get back to work or get back to school, meet friends, understand that there is other children in the world, like, you know. So, look, it has been good. Lots of wee jobs done about the house and that, but
Time to get back. You've been forelocked as well, Eoin. How has that worked out for yourself? I'm sure you're missing the interaction with the players.
Yeah, it's strange. Like, I suppose you're so busy. You're out every night of the week, every weekend, and then just for it all to stop and not allowed to leave the house. So strange now. Took a bit of adjustment over the first couple of weeks, but the house and the gardens never looked as well, and I'm definitely now, this last week, I've run out of jobs to do now, so I'm keen to get back in and do a bit of coaching, start playing a bit of football again.
Good man. I have a few jobs up in my house now. If you want to pop up, I don't mind. I could keep you occupied. And it's just about 5 kilometres, so we should be okay. Marty, how are you doing? How's all in Garrison? I know you're a busy man. Your wife is involved in working in the SWA there. So she's been on the front line, as the saying goes, and you have three young children at home and trying to hold down a job. So I'm sure it's been a difficult time for yourself.
Aye, it's been handy enough a few weeks, you know. You know yourself, the three kids there, so look after themselves at this stage, you know. It's definitely, as Doc says, it's been an experience. You know, you're at home. Aoife's at the front line in there and out of skilling, like, but I was definitely on the front line here in the house for a few weeks there with just the three kids and myself. It's
what it's age an eye-opener. Are they?
What's that?
What age are they?
1, 3, and 5. So Annie's the youngest, she's just 1 there since April, so she's getting busy. Yeah, there's plenty of looking after in the minute, but we've survived so far, which is the main thing, really. You know, that's kind of all you could hope for, really.
It's been a good test on their marriage, Marty, I suppose.
Yeah, it's been a good test of everything. You know, you've it was definitely a new experience for me now, just with the one-on-one. And normally, whenever Aoife's out of town or she's away, first thing I do is put everyone in the car and go over to my mom's house. So we couldn't do that there for a few months as well. So, like, all my outlets were gone. It was just, it was me against the world there for a while, but I made it through and I was so delighted, you know.
I can see everybody with their Kleenex boxes out here watching this tonight, you know, Marty, and their hearts go out for you.
I hear it wasn't all bad, you know. I can recite Frozen 2 from start to finish now if you want to do a wee sing along later on. I can do it. Like, there's no doubt about it. I'd say I've watched it 50 times since lockdown. So if you're interested in branching out into something a wee bit different towards the end there, just give us a shout.
Right, Frozen. Okay, Frozen 2. Right, okay. I'll make a note of that, Marty. So, but we're here to talk football tonight and player development. And maybe before we just get into it, just any one of you, a quick word on the announcement on Friday that the GAA is coming back, and the dates we have to look forward to are the 29th of June and then the 20th of July and the 31st of July with games. Your views, one of you, on that?
It's good. I suppose it was a good, it is great to get a wee bit of information, like from a player's point of view, that you can see dates in front of you that you can actually aim for, that you're actually going to be, you know, you're not timing yourself doing a run, or you're not going out and doing stuff on your own, that there's actually a date set aside there when you get back to a wee bit of collective training. And then even further down the line, you know, views of matches. From an administration point of view, the club board and the county boards around the country are going to be scratching their heads wondering how they're going to get everything into place to allow the players back to play. You know, there's a lot of hoops to jump through. So it's good in one way, but I suppose there's probably a lot of work to be done for clubs to get like things like taking temperatures and COVID officers and all this social distancing into place at your club ground. It's probably good, definitely, to have dates to aim for, but probably a bit of work as well in behind the scenes to get going, you know.
Yeah, as you say, a bit of an administrative burden for clubs, and clubs have a tough enough job getting volunteers and coaches and so on and so forth. But sure, look, I suppose it's something that we can work towards in the coming month and whatever. We have a bit of time to prepare for that. Were you surprised, Eoin, with club coming before county, or is that something you'd be advocating?
No, I think it's a good thing, because obviously the county's going to draw in bigger crowds, not there. So hopefully numbers keep going the way they are and the COVID's gone out of the community. It might open up maybe that fans can maybe start getting to see the games in October, November. So hopefully maybe the restrictions go down to 1 metre. So they're talking about maybe getting 40,000 in for all Ireland, because I know from a player that you enjoy, like it's something that you really thrive off is the crowd. And if the crowd's not there, I think I've seen a lot of county players on chatting there over this last while saying that they wouldn't looking forward to playing in front of an empty stand. I know I've been in Croke Park a few times when it's been like maybe 10,000 people in it, and it's not as enjoyable as playing maybe with it packed, you know. So I think it's good that way. At least it gives us a chance.
Yeah, and it's good too, Shaun, that the kids will get their football, you know, starting maybe at the end of July, because I suppose there's a lot of concern and worry about the mental health and well-being of the youth in particular. So at least they're going to get maybe 2 or 3 months of football. So I presume you welcome that, and that's important that they do get that time.
I think that's very important. In this whole, I suppose, last 2 or 3 months has been, I suppose, the mental health issue. I suppose I look to my neighbouring counties, a county I worked in previously, and maybe, unfortunately, there's been a few instances there of mental health issues that arose and unfortunately had bad endings. And for a lot of young people, and for older people as well, sport is an outlet to, you know, I suppose, vent at times, or, you know, even to meet friends and to just socialise. So that aspect is brilliant. Like, you know, so I think, you know, as Marty was sort of alluding to there earlier, there is a lot of obstacles the GAA need to overcome, but even a bit of light at the end of the tunnel, something for adults, youth, aim towards, I think that'll give a lot of young ones and older ones sort of a wee bit of hope. It's not going to happen overnight, but in another month or two, I think we'll be in a good place and we'll get back on the field. It'll help massively, to be honest.
Yeah, and you three men are all still playing away, so it'll be great for you, man, getting back to kicking a ball again. And I suppose for boys like me that maybe three or four football matches every week, never mind, and maybe three or four at the weekend as well. It's something for boys of my age to really look forward to. But look, guys, we could chat away, but I suppose the focus of tonight is player development in clubs. And I suppose the term player development is a relatively new term being used in the GAA this past maybe 3 to 5 years. What's your actual meaning? What do you think the player development actually means? And I'll start with yourself, Eoin. What do you see as the term meaning?
For me, it's about developing the player. So it's getting him at a young age and developing him through so he's fit into a senior team, that he's fit to deal with the rigors of the game. So it's looking at all aspects, like his skill, his strength, his physiology, his mental, everything. So it's developing. The whole goal of the club or the coaches should be develop the whole player and try and get as strong a person coming through into your senior setup as possible.
Yeah, and there's different strands to that, Shaun, I take it then, in terms of developing the youth, or developing the children, developing the youth, and then development at adult level as well.
Well, that's it. Like, I suppose you look at your long-term development pathway and all that there. I suppose touch on sort of one's point there. Big part of player development, it has to be player-centred, you know, and sort of develop the player holistically and look at all the sort of elements, and at each stage doing what's appropriate for the player. And I suppose when we go back now after this pandemic, I suppose it's sort of maybe the GAA over the last number of years has been getting a wee bit carried away, and the levels of elitism, and it's creeping into club football as well. I think one big thing we need to take away this is, and get back to it as soon as possible, it's about enjoyment for youths, for adults. That has to be the main thing. Players at all levels have to enjoy it. And without doubt, we can look at the different aspects of development, but it has to be underlined by enjoyment for the players, to be honest.
Yeah, and I mean, is that the, you know, you're alluding to the fact there, I think, Shaun, that the whole thing has become too serious and it's all about winning. Marty, would that be something you would concur with?
Yeah, like, definitely. Like you as Doc says, it's been creeping into club football now the last few years as well. Like it's becoming, you know, club football now is what county football was, you know, maybe 10 years ago, even as close as that there. Like players are expected to be doing more than your three nights a week with your senior team. Like you'd be expected to be putting in a day or two by yourself, and you're supposed to be keeping on top of your nutrition. And these are things that would have been probably alien to me whenever I started playing county football 10 years ago. Things like nutrition and conditioning and all that kind of stuff was new to me joining the county team, whereas now your average club player will be getting, you know, you'll be drilling that into your club senior players, you know, about just kind of the various aspects of your life outside, away from the training pitch, that you need to keep, you know, on top of yourself. And that's the kind of thing that takes a big effort and it's a big commitment. And if you're trying to get that into your senior players, then eventually once, you know, if you try to move that down the line, then you're starting, you're talking to your 15 and 16 year olds and asking them what they're doing about their nutrition, and are they working on their flexibility and their mobility and their all these different aspects of the game, which if you want to reach the top level, then you are going to have to be thinking about that as a young player coming through, you know, from 14, 15, 16, going on up through the ranks. Like, you have to get on top of this thing. If you want to be a serious senior county player, you need to get on top of it. But how much enjoyment is your average club player getting out of, you know, 5-6 days a week, or, you know, get, you know, everything has to be centered around the GAA. Like, there is a balance to be struck there, and you can drive the enjoyment out of it. If you make it too serious for players, they'll walk away, you know. Some players will take to it, some players will make the commitment, but like, you have to strike a balance. If you're making it not enjoyable, then you're going to lose players, you know. So it's tricky, it's hard, you're kind of you're stuck between a rock and a hard place. You want to make the best players you can, but you can't force players to do things that it's not enjoyable, because why would you do it? Why would you continue to do it? You'll go to college or you'll go somewhere and you'll just walk away.
Yeah, but I suppose, and I accept everything you've said there, Marty, but then the two lads down below, as I look at my screen here, you guys are employed to develop players and to work with players and get them to the highest level. So, you know, Shaun, are you talking yourself out of a job? And was Marty's comments talking both of you out of a job? I don't know.
For me, the first thing about the GAA when I started was that I loved it and I enjoyed it. And when I talk about, you know, that has to come back, that for me was what drove me on then to really look at my nutrition. I say this when I'm looking at my biggest challenge of lockdown is the cupboard here face that I'm looking at. It's hard to get the head out of it at times. But my love of the GAA started young, and I had good coaches that encouraged me. And then, you know what, it became easier to go on and do my strength and conditioning and do everything because my love of the game and the enjoyment I had from a young age. So I think it's important to force the love of the game, developing the skills. And when you have a mad, crazy young lad at about 14, 15, the rest of the stuff then becomes easy to do that there. But I suppose when we go back to play football, I think I'd be sort of saying that about our 12, 11. The coaches over them teams, it has to be enjoyable, because I've seen, take the feelers now. So they had to change the whole structure of the feelers because teams are going away to cart in the house, or teams are going away in team bonding weekends. That's on the 14s. Like, it became crazy. I think that needs to be readdressed, and it should be just about fun and enjoyment. And then at the latter ends, when they're getting into that sort of 16 years of age, when you have to specialise in a sport to become excel at that sport, then I think it should be a case at that stage. You look at real, real player development and, you know, putting in serious hours at it. So I'm not doing myself or Eoin or any coach out of a job, but I think it has to all be started out with enjoyment.
Yeah, but
I wasn't trying to do you out of a job either, or Doc.
Maybe you're looking at his job.
I want a few weeks rest. Hey, I don't want any jobs for a while.
Eoin, do you think that? But you know, it's easy, and maybe the past 3 months will bring a change in thinking and a change in mindsets. But maybe not. Maybe we just get back into that rat race again. But I think the key point that I'm taking from the two other lads there is that unless the enjoyment is there, then it's pointless driving lads forward and challenging them.
Yeah, definitely. I suppose that's our challenge as a coach. It's my challenge is, you know, is to try and get the lads in, getting them doing the work, but also making it enjoyable to do the work. And that's something that I always try to put across to the lads. You know, put in the hard work now, lads, and you'll enjoy your day in the field, you know, when you're winning. And, you know, it's definitely something I strived as a player. You know, I was always hungry for more. I was always asking and always looking up more and trying to more, because, you know, for me, I was always very much, when I played and still am probably, I want to win. And, you know, young lads there, Doc will tell you, Marty will tell you, even within the club, the lads want to win. They want to go out and they want to play and they want to win. And, like, something, I suppose, me and Shaun definitely seen in the first couple of years in the job was when we were going up against Calvin and all their teams and they were beating us at the blitzes and stuff, lads were annoyed and they were frustrated, you know. So it's just, I suppose, it's the way the games went. And I suppose of whatever your neighbour's doing, we're going to try and do more, you know what I mean? And that's, you know, that's just the way of football. But, like, as I said, it's definitely up to me and Shaun to make that enjoyable, and I try my best to get it across to the lads that, you know, I'm there for them. I'm there to try and make it better, and I always try to get across to them, if there's anything you don't enjoy, come and tell me and I'll try and give you something that is more enjoyable. But for the most part, you know, you will get you'll always get that 60-70% that'll fully buy in, but there is lads that just, you know, aren't willing, or they just don't see the joy, or they don't have joy in the gym. So it's just trying to work with as best you can and make it as fun as you can.
Yeah, and you know, and look, we will all aspire to develop ourselves as best we can, and the youth of the day in particular are certainly like that there. But is there not an awful lot of responsibility now on coaches? Like, you two guys are full-time coaches, and therefore you have good, evidently excellent knowledge. But then you take your ordinary club man, and you take a club like Devonish, where there's a small rural population, and you look at, you're trying to get coaches for boys and girls teams from under six, maybe right up to senior on both. I mean, and they're all meant to understand this long-term player development program, and they're meant to understand the being the holistic training that you alluded to, Shaun. You know, is that not where the gap is in terms of development players within clubs, expecting too much of coaches, or coaches not being coached enough? Shaun, I'll throw that one at you.
I think a big problem, and I suppose going around the county doing coach education between Cavan and Fermanagh now this last 12 years, a big thing with a lot of clubs is they probably don't sit down as a club and actually identify, not to steal a thing of Stuart Lancaster, but he always talked about what your brand is, what is Devonish GAA, what is their style of play, you know, or something like that there. Like, you can think of, and to credit to them, and I always say it about this club in Fermanagh, but if you think of one team in Fermanagh that have the most identifiable style of football, and they never change it, and every team plays exactly the same way, they're tough and they're very direct with how they play football. Could you think of that team? Like, to me, Timor are exactly the same at every age group, and every coach knows how to train a team. And that's what I wonder, does every team sit down and go, this is what our target is? And then it becomes very simple of how to actually coach that team, coach them age groups below. They're all playing sort of to the same tactics and the same way. To me, I think that's what a lot of clubs don't do. They bring in coaches because it's difficult to find coaches, but they sort of go, right, Jet, you're over that under 16, Eoin, you're over the under 18, Marty, you're over the under 10 team, and I'll see you next year. Instead of actually sitting down and actually identifying what needs to be done in each age group, every coach can go about doing that however they want to, but as long as the under 6 can kick a ball or hand pass a ball, the under 8 can do a wee bit more, the under 10s can do a wee bit more, they're gradually progressing and they're not even thinking about a long-term development. It just happens naturally without going into that, I suppose, big words and overcomplicating it too much. That makes sense, Dave.
Yeah. And Marty, you're the coaching officer in Devonish now at the moment. Picking up on Sean's point, is that something that you've been thinking of exploring, or maybe you're already down that road in terms of having a style of play and trying to incorporate it into all age groups?
Get Barry Owens for fall forward, maybe, but we no, like I agree with what Doc's saying there, and in terms of, like, you know, in terms of sitting down and talking about an actual brand, wouldn't be something that we would have taken, but we would have went simpler. What we tried to do, but I suppose it's only in the last year, probably towards the end of last year, that we thought about it. What we, you know, look at in its simplest terms, like, what's your goals for your senior player when you've got somebody that's 17 or 18 and going into senior football? Like, you know, things that you can actually measure are their skills, you know, right foot, left foot, like, what are you getting out of 10 from 25 yards? Like, how consistent is your shooting with your 2 feet? How consistent is your two hands for your fist passing, your catching on the run? You know, your just the basic skills. Like, are we creating 17 and 18 year olds that are going up to senior level that are first things first? Have they got the skills that they should have, you know? And then breaking that down, and as Eoin said earlier, it's introducing the right thing at the right time to these players. So, like, at what stage are we, you know, developing the other foot? Like, are we bringing that in at the right time? And the same with your physical attributes, you know, your max speed and your endurance and your even, like, getting a bit more complicated, your movement and your flexibility. Like, where are your senior players at? Where's your 17 and 18 year olds that we are creating at the minute? Like, what are they able to do, and what should they be able to do? And then, as Eoin said, at the right thing at the right time for these players, as they're coming up, you know, at underage, you know, are your 13 and 14 year olds, have you introduced them to the movements that they'll be requiring for proper strength and conditioning training down the line, you know, that kind of a thing. So starting probably at the top and looking where you want, what kind of a player you're trying to create. And then, you know, where are you going to introduce that, and what's your milestones? And the GAA player pathway will tell you a lot of it. And then you have to look at each individual as well. Like, as they're coming through the ranks, like, is our under 12 manager walking away and not speaking to our under 14 manager the year after? Like, are we actually tracking these players and finding out where they're weak and where they're strong? But there's an awful lot of work in that, Jed. As you said, like, we're a small club, like, and you're trying to introduce, you know, an idea of a structure of what you want to do and how you want your player to come to senior player. You know, it kind of feels like you get lucky if you get a good senior player sometimes, whereas if you try to break it down and try and create, you know, players that, you know, mold them in the way you want in terms of individual skills. And then, as Doc says, we can start talking about a brand and trying to implement what way you want these players to play, you know, or, you know, the skills you just kind of have to work on that down the line. But there's a lot of work in it, you know.
Yeah, and based on that there, and that, you know, from coming from Marty, that makes a lot of sense. Based on that, Eoin, does that mean that you really need to think about having a coach staying with an age group and becoming a specialist, more or less, for that age group, and maybe staying for maybe whatever it is, 4, 6, 8 years or whatever, and become a brilliant person at under 8 or under 14 or whatever, and implement the aspects of the long-term player development plan that need to be implemented at those specific age ranges?
Yeah, well, that's funny. That's what Eoin and Kelly Clare there about 6 years ago now, we sat down and restructured our whole underage system because we weren't really competing at any underage. We weren't really getting the finals and stuff like that. So we sort of, and we've got good numbers, you know, we would have 80 kids out at under eights, which is massive. So it's a lot of, first of all, it's a big issue. You have to get a lot of coaches in to manage 80 under eights. So that was first of all. So we went about upskilling our coaches. So we got them all doing the GA pathway coaching courses. So we got them up to a certain level. Then we sat down and we, exactly what the boys were saying, we established what we wanted to achieve at each age level. So we knew that our under 10s were coming into under 12s and they could all fist the ball. They could all catch the ball. So that was our outcome. And then our under 12s all had to be fit to solo the ball. And then our under 14s could run and solo the ball, both feet. So again, we set out what we wanted to achieve at each age level, and with the hope, exactly what Marty was saying, with the hope of getting 2 senior players every year, 2 lads out of our minors that would integrate into our senior team. And also stipulation that we brought in, I thought was a good idea, that we had 2 senior players with every underage team. So this was even done on a rotation. So we always put underage training on a Tuesday night, let's say at 6 o'clock. So seniors would come and down and they would coach the under 10s and then they would go on to their own training at 7:30. So it worked out well and the senior players just rotated around. And as I said, it worked out well because the young lads know all the senior players and it gives back to them because they see these boys playing on Sunday and it, you know, it just makes the young lads want to be there more. They listen more to that type of boys. And then they stay with them the whole way up. And then last year, our minors, for the first time, I think, in about 25 years, won the senior championship. And, you know, out of that there now, we were hoping we were going to get four or five good lads into our senior team. So it's a good system and it's working well for us, and I would definitely advise other clubs to do something like that, but it does take a lot of manpower, as Marty said.
So did the coaches follow that group of players through, or do the coaches stay at their and become specialists at a certain age?
No, they would follow, like, as I say, Gavi Sludden and Emma McFadden, a couple of them boys would have stayed with that minors from under 14 right up now to the minors. They were with the minors last year, and now Gavin has stepped away now for a year. He's just wanted a year, and then he'll go back down, and the hope is he'll go back in now and start with the minors again. I've took our under 16s for 3 years now, and as I say, with the hope of maybe moving into the minors maybe next year with them.
Right. And Shaun, you have a very successful underage structure in Kinnaly, producing an awful lot of good footballers, probably yourselves and maybe Derry Donnelly would probably be the top two, and the Gaels top three in terms of youth in the county. What sort of a structure have you in Kinnaly, and do you have it documented? Is there a coaching plan there that everybody's bought into?
In fairness, now it's going back possibly 15 years, if not a wee bit more. It would have been probably the main driver at that stage would have been Conor McBarn, now with over in Lisnaski. But Conor would have been a big driver in the early days, you know, again, setting up coaching mornings. There was it was quite evident in the primary schools, numbers were going up. They had dropped for a long time, and there was a massive push put on because our numbers within boys' football were dwindling. The ladies' football was coming on very strong at that stage as well. So Conor would have devised a coaching plan with obviously the help of all the other coaches in the club, you know, between himself, Darren Boyle, Kevin Guayer, you know, there was good drivers there. And then I suppose over the last 5 years anyhow, maybe 6 years, we have put a sort of a refresh program in place. I would help Francis McGovern, Thomas McElroy would be very good. And again, it's going back to what Marty and Eoin have already said. It's, we have everything blocked down in every age group. You know, we look at sort of all aspects of player development. You know, even down to under sixes. You know, we do even have something as simple as water bottles for underage, just to get them used to drinking water. You know, why do you drink water? And just, I suppose, they're feeding a lot of information in the kids from a young age. One big thing we've probably done is we probably looked at the skill set of our coaches without neglecting our older groups, but we probably got our more qualified coaches with more experience back to our youngest groups, because we felt that there was a bit of a fall off there. You know, if you were over under 12s and you were getting players that maybe just didn't have the skill sets that maybe should have been in place. So it was probably a fault from the coaching committee, you know, that we probably were putting people in places where they probably just didn't have the coaching knowledge or experience that they needed, because that underage, it's very, very difficult from under 10s down, you know, to coach, I always find. So we put probably some of our better coaches back to those age groups. Like, I can always remember Dominic Corrigan. He was down probably coaching our under 12s when Tomás and Rory were at that age group, and Declan Cathcart was back there, Kevin Gillies, you know. And I suppose this current group we have coming through, the Tom Keenan, Zach Cahines, that have come in and made a massive, Lord McKenna, made a massive impact with our senior team. Them boys, myself and Tom's father, Frank, would have went back to them with John Crudden back, and Barry Maguire back down to maybe under 12s. You know, with them, and worked our way up through the age groups with them. So we do have a good, coaching plan there in place, but we're trying to make hay when the sun shines, you know, as we have big numbers of kids.
Yeah, and many clubs would have that sort of structure, Shaun. And is that something that, you and Teresa and Eoin are trying to get other clubs upskilled in terms of having that sort of set structure that you've outlined there in place?
You know, I suppose, again, myself and Eoin came in, this must be about 3.5 years now. But I suppose initially when we came in, you did look, I knew my own club was doing it. You knew Derek Donnelly was doing it, because their success at underage is phenomenal at the minute.
Yeah.
And you did know other clubs were doing it, but not to name clubs, but you just knew that there was a lot of clubs sort of going in a wing and a prayer, hoping that players came through rather than putting the work in. And that can be various reasons why that happens. But you look now, 3.5 years on, maybe just a wee bit of renewed energy from not just myself and Eoin. We have a great team of coaches there, be it Teresa, Egan and Fabian. You know, when they were there, you know, and then you have obviously Fergal now, who's doing great work with a lot of clubs around the county. Johnny Gardy, I think he was even down with you, Marty, there recently.
Well, yeah, before the whole thing. Yeah.
You know, and then Keith is out in the ground. So there is a lot of clubs. You have to look at your Irvine's Towns. Listen to Skis putting in great work there at the minute. You know, Inniskillen through Tom Brewster is putting in huge work. Devnish, there isn't a coach education workshop where there's not 4 or 5 of them at it now, you know. So there is a lot of clubs putting a huge effort in now. You know, myself and Eoin and all the coaches and staff there, we're just mad to get out and work with clubs that want help, you know.
Yeah. And I suppose it takes time for all of that to develop. I suppose, Marty, you'd have seen that, you know, you need the right people too in clubs that have that vision and that are prepared to put in the work and have the experience like yourself and know what to do and get the right people in. Because it is all about personalities and people at the end of the day, isn't it?
It is, yeah. The coach education is a big thing probably as well, you know, and like it's probably, you know, even getting your badges, you know, your fundamental and then you're up to your level one or your foundation up to level one. But the workshops that have been put on, like we've been out in a right few of them, and there is a lot more help out there with the like of Eoin and Shaun there. Like both of the lads have been down with us and Johnny Gardy's been down with us in the last couple of years, you know, and that kind of thing, it filters down too, you know, and it does help people that, you know, if you can get somebody to come down to the club, it's a major thing, you know, especially, you know, for people of an evening there to ask them to go out to maybe go to Lissaski or go to Enniskillen to go to see something, you know, when the lads come down to Devnish, like it's a big thing, and you can get people in there and see, and that does filter down, and that'll. That just helps, but it's all about manpower. It's all about people that are willing to put the work in, you know, on the ground. Like,
I'm conscious of the time, lads, because I've just been told that this Zoom is going to check us out after 40 or 45 minutes or whatever it is. So I'm going to throw a couple of quick questions at you. These are questions that came in through social media and whatever. So the first one I have here in front of me is, and I'll give it to yourself, Doc, within the current COVID situation and the announcements that groups of up to 10 can get back to training, how important will this be for players? Maybe we've covered that to a certain extent.
Ah, look, here, it's massive, you know, from not just a physical point of view, but from social, just to see people, to get that banter going, because you do miss it, you know. I suppose for myself, I was obviously thinking about retiring and leaving, and you know, when something's taken away from you and you don't have that group of players around you, so it's massive. So it'll be great to get back to that group again. Plus, look, from a physical point of view, you know, it's all right going out and doing the runs that are set or whatever like that, but it's the whole thing about football is being able to compete and even being able to compete in training, like, you know, beating young lads in training or having a crack with young lads, or, you know, trying to beat that tour bogey in a run now and again, like, you know, so which never happens.
You're not still competing with that boy, are you? And
I give up with that.
Eoin, what type of training should teams be doing in the first few weeks back?
They should go on easy. I know managers will see that they've 3 weeks sorted a challenge up, and there's a tendency to go, just we need to get these boys fit. Don't know what they've been doing. But the last thing sort of players need now is taking them in and doing flat out heavy sprint work, because I know what's going on in my own club, sort of that 5K, 1K guys getting out for runs. So there's been very little sort of sharp sprinting stuff. So it's going to take time to build up that, because every time you sprint, there's massive loading through the hamstrings. And when you're coming into your season in January, you've usually done your 2 months strength work. So you would have built up a good strong hamstring, a good strong muscle. But the way things have been, lads haven't got to the gym. There's no, very little boys have done any weights. And as I said, they've done a lot of slow, long running stuff. So the hamstrings are going to be extremely weak, and they're going to be extremely tender. So I would just advise all coaches just to take it easy on the lads over the first 2 weeks, that, you know, do a wee bit of longer stuff, but definitely reduce the don't reduce the times too quick that you're looking lads to cover ground in, because you definitely don't want lads pulling hamstrings here in the first 2-3 weeks, and that's when they're most likely to go. And then you turn around, you have a lad pulled hamstring and you're a week out from championship. So you got to build up that intensity and that volume very, very slowly.
Yeah, another one here for you, Eoin. Players have had to be creative in this period of lockdown, but clubs also struggle with limited equipment. How can players best do strength training without access to equipment?
Be very creative. As I was telling boys there, the school bag, pile them up a few books in and stuff like that there, put a bit of weight on, doing your squats. You're not going to make massive gains in strength because, as I say, you need to sort of overload the muscle. And without equipment, you can't really do it. But you can build up the muscular endurance by doing the press-ups, the sit-ups. As I say, if you've got a school bag, throw on a bit of weight and do your body squats, stuff like that. So you can make a good improvement in your muscular endurance. And even doing your powers or doing your jumps with like 10% of your load and stuff like that there. So you can increase all that stuff. But in terms of actually getting a lot stronger, you're limited because you just don't have the load to do it.
I can understand where you're coming from there, Eoin. But Marty, just another thing for yourself, there'll be a concern as well when teams are starting back, the players could be at high risk of injury. And a man like you, you know plenty about injuries, but what preventative measures could players and coaches be implementing to ensure that maybe that's not as prevalent as maybe we think it might be?
I suppose as Eoin's saying there, is to start back and consider where you're really at. You know, even though you might be 3 weeks out from championship, it's not normal. Like, you have to take it on board where everyone's at. If you've been sitting at home for the last 3 months, then you can't really. What Eoin's saying is just right there. You can't turn around now and start into some mad sprint training or anything too crazy. Like, you just have to take it, you know, on its merits, where people are actually where we are actually at, and not where you want to be on a normal season 3 weeks before the championship. But just, you know, we are where we are now at this stage, and if the work hasn't been going in, or when people haven't been doing the training collectively, obviously since, you know, March time, so you just have to kind of take it as it is. And if you maybe take it a bit handier at the start, as Eoin was saying there, it might be better in the long run, because if you turn around now in the first 2 weeks of training and lose 2 or 3 key players, then that's, you know, that could be, you know, you'll be in a worse position than if you're slightly off the base come championship time, possibly.
Yeah, so a sensible approach from coaches is going to be key, Marty.
Yeah, I would say so. Like, I suppose it's going to be hard with underage players as well, and it's probably something that'll be, you know, that we'll have to filter down through the clubs. Like, and is that, you know, that we need to be sensible about what we're doing with young guys, especially like lads who are growing, you know, and probably have you know, you know, could be more at risk of injury than others, you know.
Yeah. And another question's come in, Shaun. How difficult is it going to be to develop players through games-based activities while adhering to social distancing? That's a good one.
Look, it's going to be very difficult. Of course, there's some games, limited amount of games you can play, but we're a contact sport, you know, and a lot of the game situations that you would put on, you know, 2 meters, I suppose it's not really replicating the demands of the game. But look, coaches, they have to get smart on their feet, and they have to adapt, and they have to maybe just, I suppose, go back to the step principle. They have to sort of adapt their training to meet these COVID regulations, but hopefully they'll only last for a short period of time. Initially, anyhow, when no one talks about going back into training, there's no reason why, maybe for the first couple of weeks anyhow, that it isn't more a drills-based approach, you know, where we're just practicing the skills, getting back, getting used to it. But as for games-based, I think for the initial period, I'd be focusing maybe just a bit of skill refinement, you know. That's what I'd be doing anyhow. And, you know, talking about what coaches are going to do over the next few weeks, I'd rather Eoin Bradley, or I'd rather a Marty O'Brien at 80% capacity, you know, playing championship football, than an injured Eoin or an injured Marty, you know. So coaches have to take a sensible approach to the next 2 to 3 weeks, like, you know, because it's not normal. It isn't in normal circumstances.
It'll probably be all right game based, like yourself, Doc. Nobody will be able to get 2 meters away. It'll probably be all right game based, like yourself. Nobody will be able to get in with 2 meters away, you know.
I've still got it, hey.
Going back to what I was going to say there about the soccer, even, you know, and you watched a bit of that German football, and you've seen the first weekend or two slow and sluggish, I think. But I seen a bit of a game there on Saturday evening, and it was a lot more sharper and even more physical contact, I thought. Do you see that being something similar with the GAA?
You know, for my part of what I have seen of the Bundesliga there at the minute, the first couple of games, it was like zonal marking. You know, players didn't sort of go in and do the tackling and that there. It was zonal. Look, for some teams, while zonal marking, hey, it could be ideal for them. Mightn't be that much of a change, you know, but it could be something similar, you know, but maybe in training. But like here, when it comes to matches and that there, I think that a lot of it will go out of the window. I can't imagine a Marty O'Brien slowing down to take the head of some man, or Eoin Bradley there being all nice to a cornerback or a wing half forward, sorry.
There wouldn't be noted for that either of them, anyway, Doc.
As managers, they can set up games, and you can do a wee bit of running with the ball and the way you want to attack, and then what happens when you lose the ball, players can run back. I think that's probably going to be where coaches are going to have to start from for a while. And then, is it the 20th of July? I'd say it'll be straight into contact then. Like, there's no fitness like a game. Like, we've all went out and trained and run and done stuff. But playing in a match is just completely different. It's that reacting to something and trying to sprint off in 10 metres. Stuff like that there. Groins are going to be weak. Knees are going to be weak. Ankles are going to be weak. You know, so it is going to be very sluggish, I'd imagine, in the first game or two. That's why I hope Tyrone isn't a straight knockout, because I'd imagine that it's going to take maybe 3 games, 4 games before you're up to speed, up to a standard. But the only good thing is, if all clubs are playing the same and nobody's cheating, everybody's going to be coming at it from the same level. So you'd like to think that's what's going to happen.
Everybody on a level playing field.
I just wonder on that there, when you talk about that, whenever a team isn't, I suppose, physically as fit as they would like to be, then is it going to come down to the team that is tactically the best set-up team that'll win these championships, you know, because maybe not the best 15, but the tactically best set-up team. So if teams are training now, initially, should it not be a case of you do your hard yards or fitness and it combined with a bit of shadowing, tactical play, like understanding every player's roles, you know. So do your hard running, do game simulations without people tackling you or anything like that there, you know. So how do we attack and how do we defend as a group, like? So maybe that's an approach you could do initially.
Yeah, or maybe it'd be more advantageous for the more youthful teams, wherever they are and popping up in the county, it might be a bit easier.
That's me. Oh,
you're saying I'm screwed.
That's all of us think.
No, I was generalising. Just one other thing, guys, when we go back to the player development within clubs, you know, people talk about tactical awareness and they talk about team play and they talk about physical fitness and the technical aspects of the game and then your lifestyle and your personal capacity. There's all these things that go into making a rounded and an excellent footballer. Is there any one of those that's more important than any of the other, Eoin?
I'm supposed to justify my job. I think he has to be physically there first. But no, you can have your older guy maybe isn't there, but he always knows where to be and always knows to intercept the ball. So, you know, from a game sense and a player sense, you know, I think that's very important. You know, with certain other skills, you can get away with missing certain other ones. So, but for me, I think physically you have to be there to compete. So if you got yourself in a shape that you can compete, well, then, you know, the rest of it you can sort of pick up. But if you know where to go, but you can't actually run into the position, or that you're getting injured every time you go out onto the pitch, or you've been pushed out of the way, well, then it's irrelevant, the fact that you're a really good footballer. The way it was always explained to me when I was younger, I had the advantage of being coached by Peter McGinnity for about 7 years when I was 16, and there was no better man. And the way it was explained to me was this, you know, if you're a wee bit faster, or a wee bit stronger than the corner forward you're marking, it doesn't matter if he's the best player in the world, he's not going to get the ball ahead of me, you know. So that's, for me, you know, having that wee bit of strength, a wee bit of fast, a wee bit of speed and ability to read the game, I think was most important, because marking boys like Peter Canavan, he may be the best player in the world, but he's only the best player if he's the ball in his hand.
Yeah, Marty, would you agree with that? Are there other aspects that
I think there are. I think there's, you know, there will be, like, it's hard to find somebody that has everything, but there's certain players, like, there'll be, you know, they'll be physically there, and there's certain players that mightn't have the physical attributes of others, but they will get by and will get to the top level because their skills are that higher, and they're thinking, probably their brain's a wee bit more tuned in on that there. But, like, I suppose it's probably mental attributes would be the main thing, as I can see, and it's probably that something you need coming through as a youngster, as Doc was talking about earlier, is the love of the game and then the want to get better and the want to develop yourself. You can make yourself, you know, you can work on your skills. If you've got the mental, if you've got it upstairs, I think, you know, the mental capacity, the hunger and that to make yourself better and then to go out on the match day and perform and to really, you know, to drive on and give it your all. I think that's probably the main thing that I'd be looking for, is somebody that really wants it, that, and is really willing to put the work in. You know, that I would say that from a mental point of view, that's key for me.
Yeah. So physical and mental, Doc, from your perspective.
I suppose it's a bit of what both of the lads were saying there. For me, anyhow, it has to be sort of that game sense. You have to have a brain for football. To be honest, I don't think. You can be as strong and as fit as you want, but and you will obviously compete and you'll do well. But I think if you don't have a brain for the game and an understanding of it, you know, I think you'll be a limited enough player. And like Marty said there, that love of the game, you know, a big thing I'd like young lads doing and young lassies across the county or any county that is to be watching football and you know, have a mad interest in it, because I'm, well, 36 now, and what I still do is I watch football, I watch boys playing at the highest level, and you try and replicate, poorly may I add, but you try and replicate what them lads do, and, you know, and what Marty was saying, that mindset as well. You're always a competitor, you know. I detest losing, you know, and I think that mindset, you know, wanting to learn, wanting to develop, and getting better each time. I think that's what I like to see younger players doing, you know. So
yeah, and you spoke there, Doc, about thinking, and it's something that interests me. Can you coach younger players to be thinking players, or is that something either you have or you don't have?
I think every aspect of the player development can be developed to some capacity. Look, there is. I'm actually just thinking of one player, but I'm not going to name names. But he would have played midfield for Canary for a lot of years. But, like, you know, very, very smart, intelligent player. But sometimes you put a ball into his hands and he became not so intelligent, you know. So, but, like, you know, I think you have to have an understanding of it. And what we try to do with young lads, be it in Cavan when I was there or now in Fermanagh, is you encourage young lads to watch football, to analyse. And I suppose it goes back to maybe what Niall and Stephen were doing on video analysis. I think players need to just watch football, watch the best players, see what they're doing. I remember always watching the likes of your Darren Fays, Anthony Cohills, you know, growing up, Seamus Moynihan. And you were trying to replicate all that there, you know. So I think younger players now need to watch as much football as they can, and that grows that sort of capacity in your head to understand football and where you got to be, what you got to do, as well as that, try to play every different position on the field so you have an understanding, you know. So I've always played through my school days as a back, and you get to understand what backs don't like and what where they're comfortable, and as a forward you try and make them uncomfortable, you know. So but that's just my way of doing it.
Yeah, no, fair point.
Back in.
Go on ahead.
Sorry, I heard Kieran Donaghy talking about this just in terms of decision making and players, and he put down a lot of attributes that he learned from basketball, because in a game of basketball he's making 400 or 500 decisions because he's the ball in his hand so much. You know, he was advocating getting young lads involved in basketball in the off-season and all, because you're putting them in situations where they're being tackled and they're having to make a decision where they give the ball away. As you maybe in Gaelic, as he put it back to you, might get the ball in your hands maybe 15 times and you're only making that 15 decisions throughout the game. As in basketball, you know, you're weighing it up as you're 300-400 times in a whole match in basketball as you're having to make a decision. So getting young lads, like especially the youth development thing that we were doing in the club, is getting them in playing 4v4 and stuff like that, where they're having to make decisions often and they're getting the ball, more contact, rather than, you know, under 10s, 15 guys against 15, because how many times are they going to touch the ball in a game, you know? So it's trying to, maybe that helps develop the player a lot better, the fact that he's having to make that decision more often.
Yeah, it helps them improve as thinkers. Every time you get the ball, you have to make a decision, I suppose, the point. Yeah. Two last questions. One for yourself, Marty. Transitioning players from under 17 to senior football is a very hot topic now. How well do you believe that the GAA in general and your club in particular and other clubs in Fermanagh are achieving that at the moment?
I think it's proven difficult. The gap seems to have got bigger with the under-17 era. That there's players that are coming up and they're maybe not where they should be. And I don't think it's just a Fermanagh thing, but definitely in Fermanagh within our club. Like, although we have had players that have come up in their first year at senior level and have been able to compete at senior football, but there does seem to be a bit bigger gap than there used to be. it's hard one to kind of put your finger on. And I know that we had a discussion on it probably before Christmas, I think it was, Doc, on what to do, like, and how to bridge the gap. I suppose it's hard to know. And whenever I was growing up, and same for the boys there, you were getting drafted into the senior setup probably earlier than you are now. And although it's probably not safer than what we were doing going up to senior level earlier, we were developing a bit more earlier because you had to, because you're going into a senior match at, you know, 16, or you're getting drafted into play reserve football at 16. I don't think we were stronger then. I think maybe the senior teams have possibly got stronger with strength and conditioning, taking on a bit of a more serious, and you've got somebody that's 16 and hasn't stopped growing yet, or, you know, that they're still developing, they're going to be miles away from a 25-year-old who's been, you know, got, you know, 10 years of strength and conditioning under their belt that are fully, like, in their prime. Like, you know, if you're only 17 years of age and you're maybe starting out your conditioning life, then you're miles away from where senior players are now. I don't know how we get our 17-year-olds to senior level at this stage. I'm not too sure what the best thing to do for it is.
Doc, have you any thoughts on that?
Again, look, it's very difficult. I've made it quite clear that any clubs I went to or any meetings in Crow Park, I didn't agree with the drop. I thought it was hard enough to transition an 18 and a half year old into senior football at that stage, but to drop it down to 17, you know, you're supposedly dependent maybe on a very mature 16 or 17 year old that has all attributes physically to hold his own. You know, I know Marty touched on it there. Maybe when I look back, I started at 16, but I was reasonably big and could reasonably hold my own. Like, but 17 year olds now are, as Marty says, coming up again, boys, with maybe 6-7 years of a training age in terms of gym, and they can't compete again that, you know. So in terms of how do we solve that issue, well, I think clubs possibly could look at, can we do some form of athletic development in order to prepare lads for that? Can there be maybe a viable under 20 or under 19 competition that could be run in the county, you know, or some form that they can be buy-in, or there needs to be some thought in that there. How do we transition lads in? Because some lads at 17 or going on 18 won't get any senior football and possibly won't even get any reserve football. So there could even be thought of a regional under maybe 18 championship, because you'll have football for your McCrory players, you'll have football for your Fermanagh College players. Some players in St. Kevin's will get college football over them winter months that'll help them develop. But predominantly at the minute, the boys that are transitioning into senior football generally have that year of McCrory football that does set them up for a senior club, you know?
Yeah.
It's a tricky one.
It's a difficult one. Yeah, it is. We could chat on that one all night, so we could, but one more that has come in here. In terms of coach education, what advice or what signposting could you do to direct coaches to learn some more and to educate themselves more? And what is the most important thing for coaches to learn? Owen, I'll throw that one at you.
I would advise all coaches to try and get to as many of them workshops as we're putting on. Like, I know me and Shaun and Theresa are sitting down, we're trying to come up with the best workshops for the coaches in the county, and I think we even done a bit of an audit there this year, going around all the county and the clubs and seeing what they would like best of all. But I would definitely say attend as many of them as you can, make contact with me and Shaun. Like, me and Shaun, and as Marty knows, anytime you contact us, we'll go out to your club and we'll put on a coaching session for you and your coaches. We run them workshops, and more often than not, it's the same guys at the workshops all the time. So I would encourage other clubs to try and push as much as you can to get the lads to come to them workshops and, as I say, come and chat to me and Shaun. If one good thing has come from this COVID situation was the fact that the amount of coaching webinars are on at the minute. Like, I know I'm at the watching 3-4 webinars a day at the minute, and there's apps, and they're all free. Well, 90% of them are free. I know Arsenal, Leinster Rugby, the GAA's running ones every Tuesday and Thursday night, and the information like is coming from is fantastic. It's all the top coaches in the game at the minute. So if one good thing has come from, there is so much educational stuff out there that maybe wasn't available 20 years ago, and you can go on and you can pick up wee bits here and there. I just think it's fantastic. But the biggest one for me would be in Fermanagh is, like, get me and Shaun out. Like, we have put it out numerous times, and I seem to go to the same clubs all the time. So, you know, it's up to the club, get us.
Yeah. Well, your services are there, and they're there to be available, and it's up to the clubs to avail of them. And Marty has highlighted the importance of you guys and others coming down to Devenish. And sorry, that was one question that did come in that I nearly missed there, Marty. It's in around the whole mindset of younger players coming from small rural clubs. Is there an inferiority complex with those young players coming from small clubs when they get in amongst the big boys and the bigger clubs, and even at county level? You could pick up on that, Eoin and Shaun as well.
You would hope not, but like it's disheartening when you look at when you're kind of stretching your age groups maybe to the limit, where you're at under 16s and you're stretching it right down to under 12s, or your minors are stretching right down to under 14s, and you're having to take up players, you know, younger players, a lot more younger players than teams you're coming up against. You know, there's clubs, like, obviously there's not massive clubs in Fermanagh, like, but there are clubs with bigger population than ours, and if you're coming up against an under 17 team that has you know 7 or 8 at that 16-17 bracket, you know, that are powerful and are, you know, in their last year, and they're stronger, it is tough, like, and it's hard for young lads. It's hard for the lads who are at that age, if maybe there's 1 or 2 16 or 17 year olds on a team versus 6 or 7, then you're just swamped. Like, and we would have had strong underage teams whenever I was playing underage, but whenever you'd come up against, it was normally Derek Onley that would put paid to us. You know, I would remember a few times where we would have had maybe, I would have been younger end of the scale, and we would have had maybe Paul O'Brien and John O'Flanagan, who would have been in their last year, and they would have been key player for us against every team. And then you'd come up against Derek Onley, and they'd have players at that age group, and maybe 2 or 3 more as well as that. So, you know, all of our, you know, your key players end up suffering because they're coming up against, you know, more numbers than them. And then your younger players are coming up against players that are older than them. It is tough, but you would hope that it would be making you tougher rather than giving you a complex, you know, that kind of way. Whereas you have to understand that this is the way it is. When you get to senior level, it's still only 15 against 15, and you're, you know, it's the drip feed that Eoin talked about earlier. You know, you're not looking to turn over a full under 17 team into a senior team. You're looking for, you know, if you get 2 good players, 3 good players, that's really all any club would be looking for every season, you know, regardless of numbers. So if you can, you know, use it as a young player coming through in a smaller population, then when you get to senior, then, you know, the playing field is leveled out. Everyone's at the same level then. You know, there are, you know, population advantages obviously, but at the same time, you know, in terms of physicality and skill, you're getting back to a level playing field. Like, so I suppose not to let it become a complex, to use it as a kind of a toughening up measure and just kind of get on with it, and your time will come, hopefully. That would be the way I'd look at it.
Yeah, and Doc, you're working with the elite players, I suppose, in the county at in terms of the development squads and under 15, 16, 17s and whatever. Do you see any of that, you know, when you come to play the Tyrones or the Armaghs of this world?
I suppose, again, look, probably initially you would have, it seemed like I don't know if Eoin would agree, but at the beginning, maybe 3.5 years ago, it just felt like a day out. Boys happy to get on a bus, happy to go, get whatever, go home. You know, it didn't probably hurt them. You know, they got that used to getting beat. They became numb to it. And it was nearly like an acceptance of it. But what we have found, and it goes back to, I suppose, earlier when I was saying it, Jed, was the enjoyment. There was no enjoyment in representing our county, but we found that by, say, Eoin or myself challenging young boys, making it tough, creating that real winner's environment, you know, we're actually starting to win more games at academy level, but it's by no means a benchmark. I'd approach it anyhow, is that it's all about getting quality players that have all the tools at their disposal come senior level. You know, Marty even touched on it there. You know, Garrison might have been getting beat at underage level, you know, in games, but ultimately it's about getting as many players through to senior level as possible so that they're playing for as long as possible. You know, like, yeah. Garrison or Devnish have won leagues championships there in not that long ago. It was only a couple of years ago we won Division 1, Marty. You know.
Yeah, 2017.
Yeah, you know, like, so there's definitely an inferiority complex with a lot of academy players there, but at the minute you don't see that. Like, currently when we were training there for the Moncrano one, like, the mindsets of the players were they were more than capable of winning this, you know. And that, I suppose, from maybe the likes of St. Michael's winning the Hogan Cup or winning the McCrory, you know, competing at the highest level, that breeds belief into everybody, not just youth, but it breeds that into senior clubs, it breeds it into everybody. You know, I've seen an interesting one Shaun Quigley had there. He was done a wee interview, and it was about getting hammered by Irvinstown. I don't know if you've seen it.
And no, his manager,
it was just said the most memorable moment playing for Roslane, I think it was something like back when he was an under 14 player getting beat by about 30 or 40 points by Irvinstown, and the manager just turned around and said, "You'll win more championships than they'll ever win," you know. And that was just a mindset. They just believe that, like, you know. So you might get beat at an underage level, like Canoli have a long time, but ultimately it's about developing the player, getting them the senior, and that's where it matters about winning and losing.
Yeah. Oh, and your take on that, just from being a Tyrone man working in Fermanagh?
Yeah, well, definitely exactly what Shaun said. Like, I suppose from my side, it was maybe a frustration in the first year coming in. Like, I came from Derry and very successful with Derry. They got the All-Ireland semi-final and won Ulster twice for the first time in a long time. But Derry had a real arrogance about them, and Tyrone as well. You know, when they go out, they don't ever believe they're going to get beat. And I came into Fermanagh and sort of alluded to earlier, like, the first year, I suppose, boys turned up late to training and doing stuff. And, you know, this was foreign to me and it frustrated me. And I, you know, something that I was, and me and Shaun definitely went about going, "Boys, this is not the way we do things. You know, it's going to change. You know, you can compete. You can actually go out and actually win something if you put it all in here and motivate yourselves." You know, and there's definitely been a shift. The lads now don't turn up training late anymore. They know what they get from me and Shaun. And, you know, there's a mindset there. But they definitely don't go out to get beat anymore. I think when they put on the Fermanagh jersey, it seems to be a wee bit of timid. But as I said, I've talked to the players before, they throw on the Smichaels jersey and they're afraid of no one. They can go out and they're world beaters. So it's trying to get that mindset across that, who cares if you're Fermanagh? As Marty alluded to, it's 15 players against 15. And as I said, I've worked with players in Derry, and I've worked with players in Dublin, I've worked with players in Tyrone. And honest to God, and I've said it to Shaun, I've said it to the lads, Fermanagh has 15 as good of players as I've seen in any of them counties, and they can compete. but maybe at times they definitely do lack that wee bit of mental strength. And that's where I suppose me and Sean's trying to change. And there is a few good teams coming through there, under 16. You know, they're constantly listening to me and Sean getting at them and trying to get that message into their head. You boys can win, you know, and it's just something.
That's a positive note to maybe wrap up on our discussion on player development within clubs. But before we wrap up, and we only have a minute or two here, guys, a couple of questions that came in. One, Marty, and I don't really know what this one is about, but you're going to have to tell me. A training session with Pete McGrath and a mystery man in red gloves. Who was at fault in a certain video? Can you enlighten me? There's a yarn there, I think.
Jeez, you're trying to draw something up now. You're testing me now. Can you give me any more context?
Well, a mystery man in red gloves, and you and Richie O'Callaghan.
I think it was Richie O'Callaghan was the man who was in my head, all right.
Uh-huh.
I'm trying to think that story now.
You've only a minute to tell it.
I'm trying to think. It's Jesus, a long time. A lot's happened since then. I've had three children since that day, Richie. So the mind starts to go blank, you know. But as far as I remember, we were looking back over a video, and somebody left a man that they never should have left, and I think that there was a bit of a debate going on as to who the man with the red gloves was. It definitely wasn't me, anyway, because I never had red gloves. But Jesus,
somebody said you went to the changing rooms and change your gloves. Is there any truth to that?
No. I always wear blue gloves.
Right. So who was the mystery man then?
It was Richie O'Callaghan, as far as I recall. I honestly don't remember the full story. I wish I did.
And the man's not here to defend himself, but I have three questions. One word answer. This one came in for you, Eoin. You love this. You alluded to this man earlier. But you've had the privilege of winning senior championships with your club. You've only won two of them, I think I'm right in saying. And the Fermanagh man has been in charge at both times, Peter McGinnity and Don Corrigan. So the question is, if you were to choose a manager, is it McGinnity or is it Dom? One word answer.
I don't think you can answer that one word.
One word answer. Each
manager comes with his own probably just because I had to start out, probably it was McGinnity. 7 years when I was 16, like, so you know, he's definitely somebody who brought me on loads.
Right, so it's Peter McGinnity. There you are, Doc.
Dom named the best players you ever worked with. And he named Marty Swift. He didn't name me, so I'm not forgiving him for that.
Isn't that all right? Doc, moving on to you very swiftly. Two devilish men that were involved with Canale. One in the 90s and one, middle of this, or the end of the last decade maybe. Brian Treacy and Jim Carday. So you have to make
a
choice.
How old do you think I am,
It doesn't matter. You know about Jim Carday, so it's up to you to tell me.
Yes, 93.
Yeah. Jim Carday or Brian Treacy?
I suppose it's easy enough for me because I played under him for 4 years. Brian Treacy, great man.
A great easy man. One.
He was
very good.
Marty, I have 60 seconds left and I want to wrap up here. So, in a word, Peter Canavan or Peter McGrath?
What's that, Jed? I can't hear you.
Peter Canavan or Peter McGrath?
That's a tough one. We had a lucky few years there. Actually, we had a few great men, didn't we? Two Peter the Greats.
Which one? Quickly.
Wee Pete, I suppose.
Which wee Pete?
I would say probably given the success we probably had, well, not success, but you know, the relative success with Peter McGrath getting the All-Ireland final.
Right, lads, I want to thank you because we're going to be cut off here. Thanks a million for joining us tonight. Brilliant show as ever, I'm sure everybody will really enjoy this. And thanks to everybody involved in Fermanagh GAA TV for all the work in the background for putting these webinars together, particularly Teresa McNabb and Phil Flanagan for their efforts. And